Travel the journey through the stories of young entrepreneurs, hear their stories of identifying themselves, and create an identity to call their own. Learn as they share their stories from behind the scenes of how they perceived to overcome challenges of their own. Dear friends, now the second panel discussion will take place, which is titled Identify and Create, where young entrepreneurs share the experiences of identifying themselves and how they got there. The session will be moderated by Mr. Sabir Haque, Assistant Professor of School of Media and Communications. Dear sir, may I request you to come on to the stage and escort the rest of the panelists. I'd like to introduce the panelists we have for today. Mr. Amough Shetty, Ms. Alma Raheem, Mr. Saad Khan, Mr. Shaik Waseem, Mr. Apoorv Bhatnagar, and Ms. Maha Hussain. Just a brief introduction about all the panelists we have for today. Starting with Mr. Amough Shetty again. Amough is a young entrepreneur who pursued BBA specializing in marketing during his years in Manipal University, Dubai. During his final semester, he worked with Osram Siemens and went on to join his in running the Dubai-based company, which has further helped grow and expand. Can we put our hands together for having him here, please? Next, we have with us Ms. Alma Raheem, graduated from Manipal University with a Bachelor of Science in Biotechnology in 2014 and began her career as a medical representative in Scientific Clinical Laboratories, Dubai. She is now promoted to Relationship Manager and involved in intensive strategic plans towards ensuring optimum client satisfaction and much more. It's a pleasure to have you with us, ma'am. Mr. Saad Khan, currently working as an associate researcher in the field of equine life sciences, where the focus lies in providing support to the racing stables in Dubai, where the support is provided through innovative treatments aimed at enhancing performance and improving recovery of current equine athletes, as well as to develop the breed athletes of the future. Welcome, sir. We have with us Mr. Shaik Waseem, an operations manager in Voltstar EM, working in commercial, industrial, residential, and multi-design build improvements. Currently working in project to lay infrastructure technology across the globe to smart serve. His experience include setting up assistance for entrepreneur network, mentoring young minds, informational speaker, and also as an event manager. Welcome, sir. We have with us Mr. Apoorv Bhatnagar, a senior interior architect at Fiona Environs, and at the same time, design director of the firm Techco, working in India and Dubai. He heads a team of 40 design professionals, working at present on more than 15 million square feet, including hospitality, housing, infrastructural and industrial projects in countries like US, Canada, UAE, Italy, Qatar, and India. Welcome, sir. And last, we have with us Ms. Maha Hussain. Oh, she has 3 years of experience in media and innovation business. After playing a key role in a radio station in the UAE, she moved on to joining a brand and marketing boutique firm. Her current role includes working with homegrown companies on creating and implementing their strategies. Welcome, ma'am. I would like to give it over to Mr. Haque.
Good morning, everyone. Morning. Just before we came for this panel session, I just a quick idea as to what is the average age of the panelists here. As compared to the previous panel session, the average age of this panel session is around 25. So you can imagine that this is going to be a much more livelier, and I would request every panelist here to be open and forthcoming as much as possible, so we can relate to the group of audience that we have here today. They're all in the final years, and just to give you an idea how this is going to work out, the next 1 hour, the goal of the next 1 hour is to understand from our panelists the challenges that they have overcome to position themselves in their individual industry, and how did they manage to find the path, or rather, how did they manage to pave a path towards their career development. And just to make it clear, the start happened right here in this corridors of Manipal University, Dubai. They are all our graduates, and we are blessed to have them here, and I'm really hoping that we go towards a very, very fulfilling session with each one of them. And most of them are in the mid-career positions. Some of them have done their masters. Some of them are maybe planning to do their masters. And just for your understanding, let me just tell you who is sitting where. We have Amough. I'm going to just start from that particular direction. We have Amough. We have Saad Khan. We have Waseem Shaik.
Thank you.
We have Apoorv here. We have Maha, and we have Alma. Just to kick things off here, I just want to know from each one of you. We'll go basically one by one. Where this set of audience are sitting today, you are also in the same stage at one point of time, in the final year. So when you were reaching your final year, what was important to you? Was getting better grades and academics was the top priority? Was it sports? Was it culture? Cultural activities? Was it to liaison with the industry to build your networking? Or you were having too much fun? So, or it could be a mix of all this. So I'm going to start with you. I just wanted to know, did you feel the pressure when you were in the final year and you didn't know what to do?
Okay, for me, I come from a family with businesses. Like, every single person has a business. And I think by the beginning of second year, I was already told, like, you know, that's your line. You have to enter the family business. And there's no moving anywhere. So for me, third year was basically, it was not about getting grades for me. It was basically the experience of the whole BBA lore to understand how business works and study about business and use that in the family business. So basically, grades, like you asked me, grades was something which I looked forward to. Obviously, there was always competition in the class, but nothing as of such that I should get a scholarship, or, you know, that wasn't in my mind. Yes, and obviously fun, because you're not college was the last thing you're going to get. Probably do masters later on, but you're not going to get that again. You know, whatever you're going to get in college, you're not going to get that again when you join work. You will get that 1 month out of 24 months to enjoy yourself, but not the same thing what you get in college. So enjoy your time in college, that's what I say.
So we're talking about getting 1 month holiday in a year and getting a holiday for 12 months.
So that was always registered in my head that I'm going to get only a month. And that also, once you start a business, I don't think you'll get it. So, yeah.
Fine, so we just move to...
For me, it was a bit different, I guess. It was a bit of a balancing act. In terms of priorities, I guess grades, yes, they're definitely important. I mean, they set you out. When I look at a piece of paper, your grade first stands out. But for me, it was always about, you know, we're in biotech, so it's a bit separate, I guess, to the separate industries we have here. But for me, it was about getting the exposure to things, getting in the experimental way, trying to get into projects. I worked on a couple of projects with some of our faculty, and I guess that kind of translated for me as well, because when you're in biotech, you have that decision to make, you know, do I want to work for a bit, or do I want to sort of go for my master's and further studies, because that's something you have to do. And I think working on the project sort of gave me more of an idea that I wanted to work for a little bit, and that's what I did. So now I've just been working for about a year and a half now, and yeah, I'm pretty pleased that I did. So I mean, in terms of doing one thing or the other, it's really what works best. Try to expose yourself to everything. I mean, I don't think I've focused on one thing in very particular. So that was what went on in the last year.
So being from biotechnology in particular, I mean, we have lots of biotechnology students here. How important is academics, and how important is it to create a portfolio of research?
That's a golden question. A lot of people see it differently. I mean, like I said, for me, that's what was important. But I mean, you do have to realize where you want to end up at the end of it. Do you want to be in research specifically? Do you want to be in industry? Do you want to join industry that's not specifically? Because now there's, for example, Alma, there's a lot of scope for people who are in biotech, and it's a required skill to have that technical know-how as well as, you know, additional skills on the side. So it's really about where you want to sort of end up. If you want to go into research, then that's what you would sort of want to expose yourself to more, because anybody that would want you for research would want to see, have you done research? I mean, the six of us have done biotech. The six of us have 90% on our mark sheet. What separates us? What translates? What's important? Do I know what I'm doing? If I'm left in a lab, can I work on my own? Can I work independently? Have I done a lot of routine work, so can I be left with samples to run things? Am I a thinker? Am I, you know, all these things sort of translate from the kind of research that you've done. So yeah, I think it's very subjective to what you want to accomplish, I guess.
Just want to go back to your brief. You mm-hmm. are a researcher in the field of equine life sciences.
That is correct.
Now, was this as a discipline introduced to you in your course itself, or this is something that you got into once you went out to the industry?
Well, I get where you're going with the question. So as per the course, we did a lot of physiology, and of course it's not the exact same thing, but that's, I think, one thing that a lot of the people here should realize, that university is not molding you for a particular niche career. It's trying to give you everything you need to be able to build up on and slot yourself in, right? So yeah, we did some physiology. We worked with the cells. Of course, the cells of equines are different. You know, there's things in there that you see that you don't ordinarily see, but I haven't encountered things that are completely foreign to me that I completely have no clue about, just because it's an equid, it's a living thing, it's right. a mammal, and so that's okay. But in terms of actually getting out and picking up more things, yeah, you do have to do that. I mean, I've had to pick up a lot of things, and I think that was one of the first things that kind of took me by surprise, was that, you know, you have known knowns, you have unknown knowns, and you have unknown unknowns, right? And just the sheer weight of the unknown unknowns just kind of came down on me when I joined. And, you know, there's multiple facets to the working world. This is just, I'm talking just about the technical work, so the horses, the computers, the cells. Then there's, you know, navigating people. There's everything, you know. Right. So,
right. That's, thank you so much for that answer. Thank you. Yeah. I'll just move on to Shaik Waseem. And, yeah, just same question. Like, you know.
Yeah, I would like to first of all thank Manipal for making a story out of me. Like, really, it was a big part, like bringing Manipal as a part of my life. And it's always like, from the time you join the college, it's really very important for everyone. And it was an important aspect for me to experiment your own strengths and weaknesses, like going into different parts of the activities, like starting up into events. And then in the parallel, you have to study your different subjects and which one you like and which one you are getting low marks and all this stuff. So this will build you really a complete credits, like you have which one to choose. Then you will have a option coming up from within you, like which one is my gut saying, like which one do I have to follow for going in, which I'm feeling comfortable, and which is like the story coming in from within you. So this is a very important part. Then just knowing yourself is very important before I say stepping out of the college and then analyzing the jungle outside. So knowing ourselves, our strengths, weaknesses is very important. And that's what happened with me. Checking up from after I graduated from Manipal, I was into many activities, like which one I love and which one is like really I'm getting irritated towards it. So it's a growing step by step activities which you have to quickly understand and recover as soon as possible, like which is the path which I have to select. Once you're selecting in, and that's all. It's an easy flow later on. So that's what happened with me as such.
Thank you. How about you, Apoorv?
To be honest, I never wanted to leave college. I mean, at that point of time when I just joined Rang De Basanti, I'd just come and I wanted to be DJ for life. I just didn't want to leave. I mean, I had such a fabulous time. And the whole idea is just this, that when I was in university over here, though, as the various panelists are from various fields as well, we had various segregations of these departments as well. But the best part about this whole thing was that, you know, when you come to the university, you're thinking, okay, I'm enrolling for a BBA, I will be a BBA graduate and so by the end of the thing. But the most important part is that though formally and based on the university guidelines, you're supposed to pass out with that, the best thing about this whole idea is that you're not forced upon to do that. You can, based on how you explore yourself and how you like to diversify yourself, find your passion within that whole field and find your passionate things to do within that whole aspect. And that's what I had done as well. Like I graduated at Bachelor's of Interior Architecture. For a namesake, yes, I am that as far as degree is concerned, but I do a lot of varied things on the building information management towards the construction industry, focusing directly. So, you know, it's really helped and it's really immense because, like, I think one of the panelists also mentioned about the fact that, you know, you focus on one subject which you like and the rest of the something you're having a hustle to do so. The idea is just this, that if you focus and you love that subject so much, why don't you just be passionate and do focus on that? You're not taking an effort to, you know, study about it. It's because of your passion to do that, that's what you're doing. And that's what it really helped me to focus on, that my degree does not really signify as to what I do. What I do is what makes me happy. And that's what I'll be doing on a day-to-day basis.
We'll definitely talk about career fulfillment in the next few points. But yes, I mean, from your point of view, after you finished your studies here, you also went and did your master's.
Correct.
So when you were in the final year, what were the pressures that you felt that you had to overcome, you know, to basically go forwards? Once you finish, what was the plan?
Oh, I had a lot of issues in my final year. One, it was just not the final year. I had actually flunked in my previous subjects as well. So, you know, I had to actually cope up with a lot of things, you know. So the previous exams and stuff like that. So I had to focus first on my 7 subjects, then a remaining of 2-3 that were in the previous semester. So, you know, my struggle was just to keep, somehow they should just get over.
So if you find yourself in that position, relax.
I know, there's nothing to actually worry because subjects are subjects. I mean, nobody's going to ask you how much you scored. Nobody's asking me how much I scored on my board exams, is it? No client of mine asked me, no client ever will ask me how much I scored in my examination, stuff like that. The bottom line is just this, that I did well, I scored well, and I make something for a living that makes me happy on a day-to-day basis. So that was my only fear happening at the final year, ki, you know, kisi na kisi reke se, like, somehow just this has to get over.
So just to give you background here, Apoorv Bhatnagar is an interior architect at Fiona Environments, and he's a director of Texture Inc. Now, there's a little bit of comparison that happens, you know, if you are, how important is academics for you? Now, you heard what Saad Khan said, that, you know, if you are in biotechnology, it is very important that you do well in academics. And if you want to get into research, then definitely your grade sheet is something that you should be proud of. And you heard the perspective of Apoorv. So it is endemic to every industry. Every industry has got different demands. And as each of the panelists have very clearly mentioned, that if you belong to a specific industry as to which direction you want to go, you need to chart and plan accordingly. Going to Maha now, I have lots of media students part of this audience. And she's going to spill a lot of beans, so I just want her to be really careful. What was going on in the final year, and how could you relate your experiences to the final year that is sitting in the audience here?
So we're being honest here, right?
Yeah.
I'll be absolutely honest. The last year, like the previous 2 years, was all about scheming how we're going to postpone our assignment deadlines. We concentrated so much on that, that I think all sort of serious things really evaded us. But having said that, I think another big part of the last year was, like Saad mentioned, a balancing act. The good part about being in media and communications is that you have a lot of opportunities to sort of use those as your stepping stones. You're doing, especially in the last year, I'm sure many of the students have already started work on it. They're doing documentaries now.
Right.
And that is a great opportunity to sort of start liaising and networking with people. You're also doing a lot of other events where you're meeting a lot of people. So if it gives you a sort of, it gives you a chance to dabble into different things. You're doing events, you're doing a documentary, you're getting into film festivals. There are all sorts of opportunities available. It gives you an opportunity to explore yourself, to understand what you really want to do, and then build upon that. So really, the last year was a balance of having fun at what we were doing, and at the same time, working really hard, of course, because we wanted to do really well. It wasn't so much about grades as much as it was about churning out the right kind of films or the ads or any sort of product that was coming out. And additionally, to figure out who were the right kind of people who you were going to network with once you graduated, or what was the kind of an impression you wanted to create on them during your final year so that, well, if they really liked you, they wanted to, would want to get in touch with you ahead. So it was a balancing act. It was fun.
Just a small disclaimer for my students here sitting in the audience. Don't ask me for extensions, okay? So we'll just move to Alma.
We get away with it.
We'll just move to Alma here. Alma, just as a person, at a personal level, what were your challenges in the final year? And we already heard Saad and how he talks about how important, if you want to get into research, for example. Now, you are working as a relationship manager with scientific clinical lab.
Exactly.
So what was going through, like going in your mind when you were in the final year? What were your challenges? What were your pressure points?
I'm going to be honest here, and I think this will also relate to all the graduating students, especially the women, right? And when you're in your final year, I'm sure all of the, you guys are getting this from your parents, when are you going to get married? Because when you finish your bachelor's, that's what your parents do. So I was, if you're asking on a personal level, that's the pressure I was getting. So as an easy way, what we all do is do our masters, right? And I've seen all my friends fall into this trap where they say, okay, my parents asked me to get married, I'm going to go and study my masters. Don't fall into that trap, because you end up doing something that you don't want to do. And in my final year, I didn't know what I wanted to do my master's in. I wasn't even sure if the degree I did was correct for me. So that was what I was going through. I was just like, I have no idea what I'm going to do. I'm graduating in 2 weeks, and I have no idea what I'm going to do next. All I knew was I didn't want to do a master's in something I wasn't sure was right for me and waste another 1 or 2 years of my life.
Right.
So that's what I started doing, and I figured the next option would be to work, and that was the best decision I made. So once you sort of start, you know, putting yourself on the field, you make connections, and you sort of, once you start working, you kind of realize what you really want to do. And now that I've sort of worked for 2 years, I know what I want to do my master's in. So I think that was what was going through the last year. I was like,
thank
I was confused.
Thank you for being honest. I mean, I'm sure it will resonate with a lot of people across all discipline, this particular point. And I think it brings to the very basic point, which is that if your parents are taking a call at this stage after you finished your graduation, you know whom to blame, but who is going to go through it? It's you. So you need to be sure of what you want to do. You need to be convinced yourself as that I want to take this decision. If it goes wrong, it doesn't go the way I would want to, I am the only one responsible for it, not my mom, not my dad. And I think at this point, it also brings a lot of career fulfillment, because you're involved on something on a day-to-day basis. You don't want to drag yourself to office. That's the last thing that you would like to do after having so much fun for 3 years. Now, since we are in the topic of career fulfillment, I'm going to go back to Alma now. You've been working at the same company since the time you have graduated. How often do you get this sense of fulfillment? Is it like every day that you feel motivated to do what you're doing?
Not to sound cheesy, but yeah, every day. because I don't know why or how, but I think I got very lucky with my job. And once you start working, you make connections and you get a lot of offers. Because, you know, I think all of us sort of are thinking, oh my God, I don't have any experience, and how am I going to get a job? But once you get that first job, that's it. You're sorted. You make the connections you need to. And I think, like for me, I really like working with my company because it's more than a company to me. It's a family, and I think I got lucky in that on that front. I know people who are not really happy with where they're working, and I think everybody has that sometimes. But for me, yeah, I do have that fulfillment, and I have got so many other offers that I have even put aside because I am happy with what I do.
Just to get a cue point from the previous panel, one of the panelists mentioned in the previous panel, I'm not sure if everyone here was on stage were there, but he mentioned that don't look for money. That should not be your first criteria when you are saying yes to your first job. What you should say yes to is something that you really would want to do. And most of the time and it's a very common thing we often hear, is that after finishing, my salary expectations is this much, you know, and I'm not going to choose any other offer. If I get an offer, even if I'm not really interested in doing that, but since I'm getting a lot of money, I would like to go for it. I would like to ask Maha at this point because I know for a fact that in media industry, you don't have the same process of hiring. Like for example, if you're going to go interview for a sales marketing job, or if you're going to go interview for a research job, media is a little complex when it comes to hiring and how you get hired. So you have changed one job. You were earlier working with Josh in a different avatar altogether, like a public figure. You were a news presenter; people could hear you. You were quite well known, and you changed your job into a different sector altogether. So, what, according to you, is career fulfillment, and how do you negotiate with that idea?
So, when I first walked into the doors of Gulf News, to be honest with you, I didn't know what exactly I was looking for. That job happened by a complete accident. I walked into the doors of Gulf News Broadcasting thinking they were a video unit, only to find out right before my interview that I was going to interview for a radio unit. And the next day I got a call for a voice test, and it was just one after the other. So at that point in time, I didn't know what career fulfillment was, and I really realized what it was going to be as the days were going by at a radio station. Conventionally speaking, everything was going for me. I was a public figure, I was doing news, which was something I was really interested in. I was getting a lot of airtime, and it wasn't because I was pushing for it. At some point, there were people pushing for me to get airtime, which is something that you would want. But after a point in time, you realize you're stagnating. And you're doing the same thing day in and day out. You're spending, my hours was 6 to 1, so I'm spending 6 to 1 sitting at my desk, researching news, sometimes news not changing over the hour, going in, doing a 2-minute piece and coming out. And while on the face of it, everything looks great and it's a lot of fun, and I know a lot of people thought I was absolutely crazy when I left that job, but at some point you start realizing that you're stagnating, and that's when I realized that that's something I don't want. That is the feeling that I wasn't very comfortable with. And so that's when my journey of looking out and trying to look for something new happened. And in that, we have been really lucky because the company I'm working with now, it's been about over 4 months. And I know for a fact that there hasn't been one day when I've done the same thing as the previous. And that keeps me going. And that, for me, today is career fulfillment. It's the idea of waking up and not thinking, oh no, I have to go to work. It's the idea of waking up and thinking, oh, you know what, I want to do this, because even if I've had a bad day previously, you want to go back and you just don't want to make the same mistake, but you want to also see what's in store for you.
Right.
And that kind of challenges you in so many ways, and I realized that during, well, my first job at some point, that I needed something that would challenge me on a day-to-day basis.
Right.
And luckily, I'm getting that now.
Thank you so much for the answer. I just want to quickly skip to Waseem Shaik, and I was going through your profile, and I could see you've been working on different kind of projects. In fact, you also have a patent which is pending for an app for e-health, if I'm not wrong.
Right.
And it is for Solve Eye, which automatically corrects vision defects.
Right.
So you've been getting into a lot of different kinds of projects. I mean, that's what your profile says. So I just want to know what keeps you going, and what is the sense of achievement that you get in getting involved in so many things?
For me, it was a hype, or I can say like getting into something which is not existing, like inventing into something that is like will help a lot of people, and solving the problems and make solutions out of it was a key interest for me from the engineering field as well. So I used to integrate engineering thing which I did in Manipal University, and used to try to solve the problems and get solutions through how much I can get it in my prospect. So these things like SolveWive as such, this was an app and it had a hardware part as such, in which we used to work upon people who had eyesight, generally for using smartphones or laptops. We created a software that will help people not to use their spectacles or goggles like that, and they can directly use the screen that will sync the sight of a person, and he doesn't need to use the creepy all the stuff. Changing, even when you're just sleeping and you get up, you need to check off your phone and then you search for your glasses and all. So
right.
We'll reduce the time frame for all these things. So excellent. Just all these things, we need to solve the problems, which I used to think it's a very important thing for me.
Right.
To go at that.
I'm going to come to Apoorv. Thank you so much for the answer.
Yeah, thank you.
Apoorv, you have worked with so many different interior design firms, and your list of projects was very long, and you have been involved with different nature of the same industry, but different nature of work. So as far as an interior architect is concerned, what gives you the sense of fulfillment?
I think when I had started within the industry, I was more or less looking for anybody to hire me who could give me the maximum amount of exposure. I did not want to be on a table and a chair for 9 to 6.
Right.
I basically wanted a particular place where I could actually go to a particular studio where I could actually just punch in my name in the morning and then go to site offices and to understand the site industry and to understand how building construction works.
Right.
You know, on a table we could decide that the functionality between a material and the conversation between a material volume and space, how that functionality works on a table, we could definitely understand in a meeting room. But how that is executed in today's day and time, and the problems that we have with versus towards time, cost, and everything else related, I think that was the main idea for me to go outside into the site industry and learn that. So fortunately, I got into companies who wanted me to be at the site offices itself. They wanted me to be design managers to head situations on site itself to finish the project. To start a project from the first block work and to actually sign the TOC statement, the transfer of certificate, I think to see the finished product and to see the first guests entering into a hospitality project, I think that gives me the career fulfillment. That tells me that what we started from one sketch pen has actually finished into a product and the client is happy. As a consultancy, we have made the money that we wanted to, and fortunately, we'll be winning awards on that project.
Excellent.
So I think that makes me, that attains career fulfillment for me.
That makes a lot of sense, right? I mean, everything that we do from the point of making a film to make sure the film completes. So the sense of completion, I think that's a key factor. I'm going to come to Saad here. I mean, we have seen that the nature of job, like for example, the kind of work that you're doing right now, it is not limited to only labs, right? Mm-hmm. So you also have to go out and meet people, and you know, so your industry is much more complex. The equine, it's not as simple as sitting in a lab and doing research. So, what brings you happiness, and what brings you the sense of fulfillment in that?
So I'll handle it in two parts. The first part is, yeah, definitely, even in my work, it's not just sitting. In fact, when I started, a lot of the biotech students here will know, it's tough. Out here, to get into research or to get into even a lab is difficult. Even if you want to work in a diagnostic lab, you need licenses. It's actually a bit of a catch-22, because as a fresher, you want to get work where you can learn something. However, to work here in a lab, you need a certain certification from the Dubai Health Authority that requires you to have work experience. Right. So this is a catch-22 that all biotech grads have to deal with. So basically, I mean, you know, even in my work, when I started, I was not in the lab. I was doing data analysis, I was working on a computer, I was doing programming. Slowly that translated to working with the actual you know, the actual athletes, understanding their physiology. And then later, finally, I had to push, and I got into the lab as well. Now, moving on to the second part, which is fulfillment, I'm very fulfilled in my job, because I guess people who go for science or research, everybody in general, actually, is inquisitive. You want to know things. You want to know how everything works. How does it fit together? And in sort of going through these different steps, now in my company, I'm one of, I think, three people that is involved on all fronts. Mm-hmm. So I start with a horse and the objective, what are we trying to do? And then from the horse, we go down to mechanics. We go down to the cell. And we go down to the computers. So I have stuff that I always am learning, knowledge that I always have to sponge, unknown unknowns. And I think that is what drives a lot of people in work and in science as well. So if you're getting into research, you want to know how everything works. And for me, this is ideal because I don't just have cells. There's a whole world to know there. I don't just have athletes. There's a whole world to know there. And I don't just have computers and statistics. Statistics is a big part as well. So math. So I think what really drives me more than anything is, yeah, just sponging, grabbing information, knowledge, and my work asked me to do it, and that's just fantastic, because a lot of the time it's about providing a result or something you can sell or whatever it is. Right. And even for that, you do have to do research, but you have to cut off at some point. You know, it has to be objective, it needs to be, you know, focused. For me, I get to wander a little bit. I get to waver around and, yeah, sort of. So I think that's what, and then, of course, like he said, you know, there's a horse, you treat it, it goes, wins a race. Well, you know, that feeling is great. You feel like, oh my God, I rode the, you know, race past the finish, even though, you know, I didn't. But you get that feeling.
But you get a sense of fulfillment because, yes, you achieve something. That sense of achievement is there.
Yeah, and I mean, that sort of translates through and through, you know, from school to uni, projects. I'm sure everyone that's organized this, by the way, I actually have to mention that I was really taken aback when I came in. I was very impressed with everything that's there and everybody involved. I'm sure it's been hectic. And when they're done, I'm sure they're going to feel
very happy.
Just great, yeah.
Can I just add to one thing what you just mentioned to that is that I think specifically for the students that are over here, I think career fulfillment, as he's also mentioned, is about reaching that finish line and it's like a victory line. But you know, career fulfillment also makes sure that you have a lot of realistic goals. Those goals can be per day basis, per week basis, per month basis, and per year basis as well. Even in today's day and time, when we build construction sites and we build projects, we have monthly targets to attain at. And believe it or not, we never are able to because of the some or the other reason that there is some kind of other problem that has limited to us to that. I think fulfillment and satisfaction can be achieved to set realistic targets on your day-to-day life as well. Attaining that, and that can be your career fulfillment.
I think no one better than talking about achieving targets than Amough, because Amough, he heads a sales team, and I'm sure you have your set of targets.
Yeah.
So why don't you talk about your achievement and your sense of achievement, and what kind of pressure you deal with when you have a target right in front of you being set by somebody else that you have to achieve at the end?
See, to achieve that target, there is pressure, and the pressure is my father. So he's the worst boss you can ever get. No, I'm not kidding. The thing is that, see, for me, I've come from a marketing background completely, and I've done my marketing major in BBA here. And stepping from that and moving on to the IT side, which is a solution, CCTV solution company, it was different. It was difficult, okay? But at the same time, I realized, like, you know, because my company, which the family business, is more, it's not just one thing. It's not just like trading, you know, buying products, selling here. It's not like that. It's buying the products, installing, supply, you know, do the whole solution altogether. And like he said, you know, there are goals, you know, there are goals that you have, and you'll never achieve it, especially in the Dubai market. There's always something that happens. And I don't want to name things, but yeah, there are people in the market who make sure that it doesn't happen for you, you know. So yeah, for now, coming back to the career fulfillment aspect, for me, career fulfillment is what, like Maha said, like getting up, waking up every morning, and you know, saying that, okay, today is a new day. Today I'm going to do something new. Okay, today there is this to complete. So making sure it's not like work. When you're waking up, it's like, oh shit, you know, there's work, I have to do this, I have to finish this. If you don't do that, and if you find out, like, okay, you know, there's something fun to do the next day, or now, you know, for me, everybody keeps telling me, hey, you're your own boss. You can do whatever you want. Well, that's a good thing, technically, because I can do whatever I want to do. Like, I can do things my way, basically. And there's nobody to question me except for my father. But that's the thing. So, you know, there's not much pressure. Again, I'm not saying, I'm just joking about my father, but he's pretty chill. But the thing is, career fulfillment for me is two things. One is for, even for the students around here, sitting here, waking up every morning and doing something which you love. And for me, I even though IT was something completely separate from whatever I did in marketing, I actually got a very good interest in it because IT is booming and everybody has an iPhone and everyone has, you know, there's new things and it's actually amazing what IT is coming up with, and people are actually attracted to it. So, and that's what we do. So that's what, you know, we use that technology and, you know, show it to our clients and show it to the world, show it to the city. And so for one thing is waking up every morning. And second thing for me, personal goals is, my company is relatively a smaller company. It's just 10 years old. So probably being one of the big guns in the UAE is, for me, if I get my company to one of the big guns in the industry, is a career fulfillment. So
there are a lot of students here who might find themselves in the same position where they have to take care of the family business.
Yes.
And there might be people sitting here who wants to branch out as an entrepreneur.
Yes.
And you pretty much, you know, when you finished your course here and, you know, you had a set goal, you had to join your dad's business. So what advice would you like to give to the finalist students right now who are in the same stage that at you were?
Okay. See, if for me, I had no choice, but it was something you shouldn't be like a burden to you, like saying like, you know, there's no other choice. Okay, I have to do this. My life is in ruins. Forget about that. So try to find interest. This is what I did was, see, IT, like I said, IT was completely different. And I you know, I had no other choice. Basically, I didn't have to have that mindset saying, okay, I don't have any other choice. It's just that, okay, this is my goal. IT is what I have to learn. Telephone systems, you know, IT solutions, server solutions, these are something which I have to learn and I have to do it. And you begin to get an interest in it. So if, irrespective of that, if you try it, if whatever business your family is into, and if you try it and if you do not like it, then I think you have to pull out. But if you can find some interest in it, if you think, see, for, I know it's a very selfish thing to say, but making money is one of the best things, you know, you can do. Like, everybody wants to make money here. And if you can make money in your family business and you can grow it, and if that makes you happy and makes your family happy, because there's a separate reputation within the family that you should have, you know. I'm sure, like, everyone's come from a very big family. Indian families are usually a very big family, and you want to be that guy in the family, in the whole family, like, you know, this guy is up there. And if that makes you happy, then why not just go ahead and, you know, do it.
I think our connection point has always been coming back to the university. So the university has really been the middle person for us. I've constantly been in touch with you, with all of our other professors, and if there ever has been a problem-solving situation, then it's always been these guys to the rescue. But having said that, once you're in the industry, the media industry is really not too big in Dubai or in the UAE.
It's a very small world.
And I've realized that so much more because you meet people all the time who have some sort of a connecting point to you. And with that, I've met a lot of Manipal students on the way. And it helps because the minute you have that common link and you have that sense of I can relate to you, you know, we've been from the same university and then we're talking about the same people, that very minute you've sort of established a relationship of comfort. And then that sense of awkwardness has been eliminated, and then from there on you're building a good relationship. That relationship could work particularly with regard to your job, or it could work for you in the future. But it does work. So what I'm really trying to say is, while we didn't make the best of the opportunity, if the university is giving you that scope, take it up. And go beyond that. Get in touch with people, speak to them. You never know what kind of, while you're in university, you're really in a cocooned environment. Everything's really nice and hunky-dory. And then you get out of here and the unknowns happen. And to reduce that unknown unknowns, I think it's very important, especially if you're in the media industry, it's very important for you to reach out, speak to people.
So as a, I mean, as a message to all the students here, from all the school, we love you a lot. And we would want you to stay connected with us, even after you finish your courses here. And I would particularly ask Apoorv, because I see he has a very friendly chit-chat that happens that when he meets an interior design faculty. So what was your relationship like, and how did you maintain it?
Is your question relating to primarily as an alumni, or is it primarily relating to the university?
What I want to find out from you is, as an alumni of this university, how did you manage to maintain a connection with the university? What were the factors so that we can learn from this experience and we can replicate it as we go along?
I think one of the biggest things that at least my department had done, this is a live example that I can give you. Last year, somewhere on the same time, I had got a call from Bhakti ma'am, and she had mentioned that, you know, there's an alumni meet that's going to happen. So, you know, I really want you to come. And the first thing is that if any of my professors, first of all, call me to do something or the other, there are many professors who taught me who are actually not in the university also now, and I still keep in touch with them. But when she called me, I could not say no, and I really came there. So there was a good discussion of different people in the industry who showcased their own projects and everything. And there I had met a lot of people from this company called Nikin Sakai. And ladies and gentlemen, I'm having a meeting next week in Nikin Sakai. It's been almost 6 months that we have been talking, and we are going to start a new project on building information management tomorrow, by next week itself.
Excellent.
So, this whole, my connection with the alumni and my connection with the university has helped me score projects, helped me score a marketing. And I think what the university and yourself and your team does is that they get a collection of the design professionals within the industry, and they have a good communication of sorts. Till last year, I was just a young, brash entrepreneur who believed in, you know, in Dipinder Goyal of Zomato and Flipkarts and all those kinds of things. Except that I wanted to attain something within the construction industry. Right. And I am still striving. The hustle is still there. I still commit mistakes on a day-to-day basis. But the point is just this, that these mistakes and these things and these all these fallbacks, the university has taught me how to cope up with it. And there is, I believe that any time of the day, any time of the hour, if like Maha has also said the same, I can just pick up the phone and speak to any of my professors and ask them, how do I get past this? You know, I'm getting paranoid. I cannot really get out of this situation. Mm-hmm. You know, there are people who are in this industry who are in their late 50s and 60s, and I'm just late in my 20s. So, you know, it's the hustle. How do I match to their own level? How do I get through this? So that is what the alumni connection and that is what the university connection has really, really helped me attain new things and to get to that level of things. So it's like a family itself, except it's just not the same.
Thank you so much.
Yeah.
Now, in particular, I want to point a question to Saad, because as part of your academics, you, in your final year and if you do masters, and you do a whole lot of projects with your faculty. Mm-hmm. You are co-writing papers with them. You definitely learn a lot, because as far as writing papers are concerned, and they become your mentor sorts, and you're working on a combined project. So after you finish, for example, and you go out and you do your own research, how does that experience help you? And in particular, how does that build that relationship that you have managed to build with your mentors?
I mean, after leaving, I think you leave with the nuggets of knowledge that you get while working with them. With regards to the actual sort of work that you get up to, I haven't yet come across a moment where I've had to sort of fall back to the faculty and find out about a question, because that's just me. I honestly, I would just Google. Pretty much, or open up a book, not bother them, I guess. But it has been really useful, actually, the university for me, because even the job that I have now, I mean, they try their best to do things for you, and they let you know of opportunities. There's this opportunity, that opportunity, because like I said, this is a tough market in Dubai for research. There's not much.
Right.
So that definitely helps. Then, you know, like I said, our field is a little bit wide. It's sort of open-ended. There's no sort of rule book, and I guess there is in any field, really. Yeah. So it's always nice where you can sit and talk with your faculty, and sort of they've seen it, they know the ropes, and they can advise you as to what you want to do. I have had, though, on my front, many discussions while I was still in university with the faculty, and they would always ask, what are you planning to do, what's your plan, how do you plan to, where do you plan to go, what do you plan to study in, and they sort of guide you based on what they know, and I think that was pretty useful.
Right.
Coming out of university, because like I said, you know, you're facing the abyss, and it's always useful to have someone, even now, to just hold your hand and guide you through.
True.
So yeah, I think that's where they helped. Also with, you know, like I said, careers and stuff, jobs, that always
helps. You always need a connection, it definitely helps.
It definitely helps, and then even for us, knowing the faculty as an alumnus, I mean, in terms of coming back to the university, because a lot of the alumni things are also about establishing careers for the kids, like for kids, right. I'm 2 years older, for the guys here. you sort of are very well aware of what you're getting. So for example, right. You know, I have two more faculties right here. So, you know, I can talk to a potential student, of course, I'm not in that position yet, guys, not yet, but in the future, I can speak to them and know who they studied with, and I'll get an idea of what kind of student they are. And it's always nice because I've gone through the same thing. I can turn around and I can ask them, so, sir, I'm looking at so-and-so student, and how are they? Can you tell me about them? So I think that relationship is important, and it does exist, and it does actually work. Often, when I was in uni, we used to have the alumni meets, and I used to think, well, why are we doing this? You know, we organized one as well. I was part of it, and right. I said, why are we doing this, you know, for biotech especially? And then now, on the other end, I do see value in it. I do see why an alumnus would want to come back and recruit someone. Not just because they went to the same uni, okay, Manipal, why not? It's true, but it's also that I know what I'm getting with you a lot more, and this rolls back to what I said earlier. If I have right. 4 pieces of paper and I want to hire, I know what I'm getting a little bit more with this one than I do with the other 3. So I think that in terms of a relationship does work.
Thank you so much, thank you. Waseem, I do understand that, you know, you're into innovation and you want to find solutions. And in the last few years, we have seen that the School of Engineering and IT has really upped their game when it comes to create and to work with innovation. We, in fact, we have an innovation center now within the university. So when you were studying here, you know, I'm sure this entire culture of finding solutions and looking for solutions and making life easier
yeah.
must have been inculcated during your education here itself. So, I mean, just wanted to know from your perspective, as far as engineering students here are concerned, you
right.
know, how important is it to keep yourself connected to the university so that you have the sense of, you know?
Yeah, as for now, I think Manipal is running ahead of the time. Like having an innovation center in the Middle East is really a new thing. From past 2-3 years, I have seen just one innovation center, which when I was in my engineering, I went through its turn 8, as for the name. So currently there are 5 innovation centers, which are government held by that. And the innovation having within the Manipal is really a good head start for the students who are willing to
go into something new.
So in the other aspect as such, like I always think like is sharing is gaining. Like you have to share your ideas with a set of people around you, make a team, and then things will start getting upon it. Like you have to share your thoughts, you have to share others' thoughts, attend brainstorming sessions every now and then, every weekly. You have to set up something like just how you go outside for a movie. You have to set up something like a brainstorming session, like in a weekend somewhere else. So you have to have an environment where you can create some new things. As such, Manipal has now Innovation Center. It was launched November. So this is a very good aspect for each and everyone to try out something new, getting into the market, looking out something new, because it's really new in the Middle East. If you go to the USA, Silicon Valley, it's been like ages.
Right.
But
right.
in here, UAE, it's really new, and I guess it's a huge aspect for everyone to learn a lot and share a lot and give what they are really into it. And they have really a good chance in Manipal to start something new. And as such, Manipal is just also affiliating with some other big innovation firms like 3M
right.
and GE, General Electric, as such. So you have a basic home base from where
platform.
Exactly, a home base platform where you will have a set of environment where you will have people who trust you, because trust is really important. And you, as a youngster, I really had trust issues, like setting up with investors and all. Like they'll say, "Are you above 25?" And yeah, I said,
"I get
no."
The same. I get the
yeah,
same.
Yeah, it's everyone, everybody in the same story. We have a different story, but the problems are gonna come. Just make sure the problems are not the stoppers. It's just a speed bump. You need to go ahead with your own story, like your own goal. So that's going to come. Problems are going to come to you. I'm not saying life is going to be really easy after graduating, as parents say. So you have to make a deliberate, constant effort on continuing your goals, and then probably good things will come, and you will really gain a lot of confidence within you after you attain step-by-step goals, as other fellow mates have said. Like, getting a fulfillment within yourself is really important, and believe in you is a very big deal, actually. Believing in yourself, when people are pointing out like, no, it can't be done, out of like, I approached some guys like 7-8 times, like investors, like, because they are very crucial for me, because in some ideas only few people are interested into it. And when you're approaching a new thing which has not been existed in this market, you have to inherit the faith into them. Like, you know, you believe that this, you have this, your, this is your idea, it's gonna run like a fire. But you have to tell those investors, you have to convey them that this is my reality, it's gonna come up, it's gonna hit up into the market really well, it will solve the employment issues, it will solve the traffic issues which I'm now working upon.
Right.
So these things are really important to convey the message and get the trust within your team members. And being into Manipal as such, you have an innovation center, so you have already. So next of all is just going out and just being with Manipal as such, how long it's, if you feel to be. Like me, myself, now it's been almost every now and then I come to Manipal.
That's great.
Yeah, I come to Manipal, share my own ideas, try to work in. Because as for patent issues, like a patent is not an easy thing. You'll have to wait 3-4 years, and then you'll have issue with the attorneys. Maybe they will ruin it up or something like that. So if you're going with the university, it's much easier. So I'll say like university is really a home base for everything, whatever you want to achieve as such.
Thank you so much. Yeah. Thank you.
I think he said sharing ideas.
Right.
Which I think is a very, very crucial word. I exactly go through the same thing of investors' hierarchy and the whole jingbang, what he goes through on a day-to-day basis. But the whole idea about sharing ideas is just this, that when I was in college, when I was studying, I had esteemed people in the industry who mentioned this one line, that the future of the industry are the people who are sitting in front of us. I was sitting somewhere there at that point of time. And today I would say the same as well, that the future of our industry, of all of our industry, are the people who are sitting in front of us. Even today, sometimes when I come to the university, I have a small chat with the professors, and then I just go from class to class, class to class, class to class, to see what people are doing, to start talking to them, to understand what's happening, because by the time I start my car, I already have 10 more ideas.
Right. So lots of fresh ideas are discussed in university, and I think that's something that we should continue doing.
Paying attention is really crucial. Paying an active attention, like, it's very important for your thing. And just work on what you feel like working on. And it's very important, like running a business or a company is not a one-man thing.
You
have
to
create an environment where people will believe in you, even when you don't believe. Sometimes it happens, like you lose your faith. Okay, I'm rejected, being rejected 25 times now. It's done, this my idea is gone. But keeping into an environment where you have people who will enforce you, they will unite you, just like sticks. Like, you have seen the advertisement, like one stick, it will break in seconds.
Correct.
If you have like 10, 20 sticks, it's really hard to break it. So that's what I say. Believe, and then having a keen attention, and making a team of your some super humans, like uniting superhumans is very important.
Right.
Then you can go up.
I just want to close things off here just with one very important aspect that is present in our course regulation in where you mentioned, you heard Dr. Kota speaking about something called OBTL that we're trying to implement, which will make the learning objectives of the students very clear. We have a very important aspect in that. It's called graduate attributes. And graduate attributes is something that this graduate should exhibit once they leave the university and go looking for a job. So just in three bullet points, I just want to each one of you to just give me, from your understanding, from your industry, what should be the three graduate attributes that this bunch of people right now in the audience should have to get a winning shot of achieving what they want to achieve. Either it could be getting a job, either it could be getting into further education, or anything which is endemic to that particular industry. What are the three important attributes you feel that every graduate should have? Particularly talking about your own industry, for example. So I'll start with Alma.
So because my industry is very niche in Dubai, I would say being open-minded, being energetic or hardworking, because you will get shut down everywhere when you're looking for something. So to keep going.
So be persistent.
Yeah, persistent. So open-minded, persistent, and what would be the last thing? I don't know. Maybe I'll fill in the third one later.
Fine. I'll come back to you for the third one. Maha, how about you?
Be open to learning. I think it's very important for people to be open to the idea of learning, and that is a very all-encompassing term. But that's one. So be open to learning, be flexible. And I'll take from her point, be persistent. In brackets, be a little thick-skinned. There are a lot of people who are going to say a lot of things to you, especially because you're a fresher. You're going to find a lot of people giving you a lot of advice, shooting you down, saying things to you that you probably don't want to hear, or you know for a fact that you're not deserving of. But take everything in and then respond to it as though it was actually constructive criticism, and surprise people.
Excellent. Apoorv?
I think the first and foremost is this, the dedication and the zeal to perform, to have something of, you know, as we said, career fulfillment. I think my most important point is actually the second point, is to work every day as if you are the CEO of the company and you represent that company on your own. You are the director of the company yourself. You might be a fresh graduate, but the day you represent yourself in front of any client that you are the company, you are the director, you are the CEO of this company that you're representing, I think that will go on a long way forward. And the third most important thing that I have to say is that to actually keep on hustling. Keep on hustling, keep on going on, keep on going with it. Go from, there is nothing as 9 to 6. There's absolutely nothing as 9 to 6. The point is just this, every day that you come and every day that you go, if you can look in front of the mirror and feel satisfied as to what you have done, do that. Those are my three points.
Waseem, particularly from the engineering background, you know, there's a whole lot of competition. I'll talk about the same to other panels also. So like, as an engineer, what are the three attributes that you feel that our graduates should have to have the best shot?
Yeah, I will give a whole summary about like engineer aspect. Every human being, like as a student, I believe that you should believe. You should believe in yourself. This is a core aspect which will be like a staff when you're down, when your really life hits you down and you need to get up. So you have to believe in yourself, and obviously that will bring you back, right back. And you should have a reason or a goal, what I say. Like you should have a like really goal, a really important goal. Like why I need to get up? Like why I need to get up 3:30 in the morning? Why I love sleeping, everybody loves sleeping. So why do I need to get up early morning? And you should have a certain reason that will bound you up and that will tell you like, let's go. So three things what I suppose is believe, and you should have a goal. And the third thing is sharing wisdom. Like, especially youngsters right now, like, I don't have that much wisdom or knowledge about all the stuff which I should have. So what I do is like, I share his thoughts. What I'm doing is sharing, and I'm getting my own self. So you should have some teamwork which will share your own knowledge that will get you where you want to go.
Saad, I mean, we are talking about very general, ideas here. like how and what you should have. Now, those are common attributes that I think all graduates should exhibit.
Yes.
But particularly from biotechnology, you know, what are the three attributes you feel that a graduate should have to get a shot?
So to be very honest, I feel like all graduates should generally exhibit the same things.
Right.
You know, when you're graduating, and it's drive, all these things, you know, belief in yourself. But I think really it just comes down to one thing at the end of your 3 years or your four or your five. It comes down to knowing yourself. What do I mean specifically? It comes down to skills.
Skills.
Skills. It comes right. down to knowing your market and then subsequently knowing yourself. If you know yourself and you know your skills and your market, you know exactly what someone who's looking for you to come into their company is looking for. They know what you bring. They know you're going to do this for my company and this is why you are valuable. And that all stems from really knowing yourself. Now, since you asked me specifically about biotech, it applies the same way. What skills do you have? What laboratory equipment have you used?
Right.
In using that equipment, do you really know what you're doing or are you following protocols? Right? And more on top of that, have you run experiments? Do you have the experimental mind? I mean, can you do running an experiment in a class which your faculty gives you and one in real life are two very different things. I mean, it prepares you for it. And if you engage in it, then you'll be prepared. You know, you'll know that, look, I have an objective. I need to accomplish this. How do I do it? There's everything that's involved, statistics, maths. How do I prove it? What am I trying to prove? You know, so all this comes out from, I guess, specifically what experiments you've been involved with. Have you seen it through from the start to the finish?
Right.
Did you play a specific part in it?
Right.
And skills. So it should really, you can find your truth in whatever is there. So even if something vague and general is there, I mean, people usually cringe when there's a cliche, but a cliche is there for a reason. You find your truth in it, right?
True.
So yeah, I think really, know yourself, know your market, and know your skills. But all of it, one point. Know yourself at the end of 3 years. That's what I would suggest.
Thank you. Really. Thank you. Amough, I mean, as a business student,
yeah.
You know, there's a whole lot of competition in the market, and
right.
I know all the graduates who are doing the BBA and MBA, they have a huge competitive market to really fight. So, what are the key ingredients or the key characteristics that a business student should exhibit when going out looking for a job?
The key things mainly are, see, there will be failures in because Dubai as a market is it's growing every single day. There are new, there's financial center out, there's media city out, there's internet city out. So there's different kind of businesses grow, you know, actually you can say every day there's a new business coming up and that's competition. So competition leads to stress, leads to all of this. So what I suggest is if you fall down, don't stay there. Like, get up. Okay. Don't try to be like, you know. Don't give up. Basically, that's one of the major key factors in a market of UAE. That would be one of the first things that, as an entrepreneur, these are the points which you have to stick to. Second, as an entrepreneur, I think leadership and decision making. These are the two very key factors. In being an entrepreneur in
UAE, to make a decision.
You have to you have to make quick decisions. Basically, you can't just say, "Okay, fine, I'll take
we'll
my
think
time."
About it.
You have to because you're going to make these decisions in front of your team, and you have to look strong in front of them. You can't look weak and say that you know, okay.
I don't know what I'm doing.
Yeah, I don't. Let's just wait. I'll go home, think about it, come back, and tell you tomorrow.
Right.
You can't do that. So you have to make quick decisions. At the same time, you have to think quickly, like what are the risks to this decision? Whether I can take care of these risks, whether it will be a big problem in the future for me, or is it, you know, these are the points which you have to take up, and
right.
you have to be ready for these risks which will come forward. And third thing maybe would be being like Maha said, being thick-skinned, you know, and being able to learn. There will be a lot of people, you know, pushing you down, pulling you down, because if, as an entrepreneur, you are in competition, and you're going to be in competition with the small guns, you'll be in competition with the big guns. And clients will probably come and tell you, like, you know, this is not your thing, you can't do this, whereas you know you can do it. So you don't have to believe, you don't have to be like, okay, you know, he just told me I can't do it, so I don't think this is my thing, I should just back out. No, you have to go forward, you have to move forward. And that's when you be thick-skinned. And then at the same time, what I think one of the major things is to learn. To learn from, see, because we all, even us and even the students over here, are we are all very young, and there's a huge life ahead of us, and there are a lot of people in the market who are probably here in UAE. They've here for the past 30, 35 years. They've seen UAE, they've seen Dubai from a very small market to a massive market. Right. So they know what was hard work. They know what went through, what was wrong, what was right. So learn from them and copy them if it's possible. Like, you know, how they live their life and, you know, learn their experiences. And I'm telling you, that's very, very important in the future.
So for every entrepreneur, everybody who wants to branch out and find your grounds in your industry, we have heard people from different diverse industries here. We have heard an entrepreneur. We have understood how and what it takes to go out there and find your way. And I'm really thankful to this young bunch of people who just came and we got together and we discussed. I really hope that this session was helpful for you. I was told that this session was supposed to be for 1 hour and 15 minutes. I think I just completed that. That leaves me with no scope for audience questions. I'm really sorry. We just overshoot our time. So I'd like to thank you all for coming
today. It's an honor, sir.
And taking the conversation forward, we want you to stay connected with us as an alumni, and we value you as an alumni. And you will be an alumni one day, and we love you all. So
staying in Manipal is
stay connected, and wish you all the best for your future. Thank you so much. Thank you.
I'll tell you what, by the time I'm 42, I'm becoming an external faculty.
Maybe we can talk to your faculty, and you don't have to wait for that long. Okay. So I would like to pass on the stage to the host here, and thank you all for joining us.
Thank you very much, sir. I'd like to request Dr. Fahim to come over and give away the token of appreciation to the panelists as well as the moderator. To begin with, Mr. Amough Shetty. Ms. Alma Raheem. Mr. Shaik Waseem. Mr. Apoorv Bhatnagar. Ms. Maha Hussain. Mr. Saad Khan. Last but not the least, our fantastic assistant professor, Mr. Sabir Haque. Thank you very much, sir. May I please request all the panelists to gather us for a photograph?